and we have to really escalate the noise we make so that we'll be heard.
Welcome to Gay USA. I'm Andy Hubb.
I'm Ann Northrup.
And we start with some good news. A court orders Nebraska to end its ban on lesbian and gay foster parents. And the Mississippi ban on adoption by gay couples, the last one in the country, is being challenged. And the NCLR, the National Center for Lesbian Rights, has launched a national campaign for equal rights for lesbian and gay parents.
Sounds like a good idea. We were going to show you the trailer for the new movie Stonewall last week, just as a little teaser for the movie coming out, but we didn't have time, and it's a good thing because there's controversy that's blown up in the last week. So now we have a real discussion of that.
A firestorm.
Offer, yes.
Transgender rights have advanced this past week in Puerto Rico, California, Chicago, and Poland. But they've been set back in New Jersey and in Detroit and Dallas. The 12th and 13th murders of trans women in the United States this year have been recorded.
And then we have my favorite story of the week, which is almost unbelievable. But what I'll tell you about it is just that a right-wing, anti-gay Michigan representative, state representative, has started gay rumors about himself. And it gets more interesting from there.
And if we have any time left, we will review the Republican presidential debate from last week, which we
Sad story from Australia, very awful. A rapist in Australia is distressed that his victim has HIV.
And staying in Australia, the right-wing government there has blocked a vote on same-sex marriage for as long as they are in power.
Well, maybe. There are other ways around that. And we'll bring you some reports on pride celebrations in the countries of Jamaica and Uganda.
But we start in Nebraska, where in an ACLU suit, a state district judge has ruled that discrimination against gay and lesbian foster parents is unconstitutional. This policy was set in 1995.
And in Mississippi, which is the last state in the union with an outright legal ban on same-sex couples adopting, several couples, same-sex couples, and organizations like the Campaign for Southern Equality and lawyer Robbie Kaplan, who won the Windsor case at the United States Supreme Court, have filed suit to challenge that ban, and the thinking is that they're going to pretty easily overturn that adoption ban by same-sex couples in Mississippi.
It was only instituted in the year 2000, and the Family Equality Council is also involved in that case. And then there's the fact that the National Center for Lesbian Rights, and we have a chyron about this, has launched the Equality for Families campaign to reform all the state laws that still discriminate against lesbian and gay parents and their rights, because even though we've won the marriage decision and everything, there are still obstacles in some states, and there are perils for parents who have their rights in New York, and then they travel to another state,
sure,
and they don't have their rights. So they're trying to sort all this out. There's a lot of work still to be done.
There is, but I'd say we're 75% of the way there, and
okay,
we're now looking at all the nuances of this. For instance, in Ohio, there's a judge who didn't want to perform same-sex marriages, so he said he's not going to perform any marriages. But the Ohio Board of Professional Conduct says that the judge must perform all marriages, and if he refuses, he can, in other cases that have, say, a gay angle to them, be accused of bias and unprofessional conduct.
Now, they call this an advisory opinion.
Yes, but the judge has already said, this judge anyway,
okay,
that he will,
yeah, okay,
okay, I'll do the same-sex marriages.
Because he's thinking he might lose his job.
So I guess his objections were not too deep.
Okay. In marriage news, in Puerto Rico, the Secretary of Housing there came out and married his partner. This is Alberto Lastra Power, and he's the first out gay cabinet member now.
Couple of stories on fees paid to attorneys in same-sex marriage cases that worked their way through the courts in the last year or two. In South Carolina, a court there has ordered the state to pay attorneys' fees in the marriage case to the attorneys representing same-sex couples.
$135,000 of your tax dollars because of these right-wing governments there.
Well, the state government, the state attorney or whatever in South Carolina who had been fighting the payment of these fees said, look, the Fourth Circuit had already decided for same-sex marriage in Virginia when this case came up in South Carolina. So these attorneys couldn't have had to work too hard. So why should they get $135,000?
Well, the question for him, of course, is why were you the only state in the Fourth Circuit after the Virginia decision to still contest this, you loser? I mean,
that's basically what the judge
said. Wait a minute.
It's
starting to sound like Donald Trump calling the guy a loser.
And a whiner. Except that Trump likes being a whiner.
More on this later.
I hope so. At any rate, the judge said, you loser. If you hadn't bought this in the first place, they wouldn't have had to stay up nights working to win this against you.
Just trying to defend South Carolina law. Now, in Texas, the attorney general there, Ken Paxton, we told you that he's under indictment for securities fraud, but he will no longer face contempt charges now that he has agreed to update the vital records policies for same-sex couples. A gay man in Houston
said
gay men in Houston said the state refused to amend the death certificate of his late husband. Have a heart, Ken. You're going to jail.
Hey, he's just following the law. But since the court ordered the recognition of the husband, the widower, on the death certificate, he's no longer under a contempt order. In Indiana, the law firm of Kirkland and Ellis was instrumental in working on the marriage case there, and they received fees from the court of $307,000 and $307,397, and they have donated that entire fee to Lambda Legal Defense.
Now, pay attention to this closely if you've gotten recently married and you're getting Social Security checks, because some people who got married were receiving Social Security benefits still based on the fact that they were single as individuals. They were getting more than they would have gotten if the Social Security recognized that they were married. They were overpaid. The government came after this money. So these people said, hey, give us a break, you know? Well, a federal judge tossed their lawsuit and said, you've got to go through all your administrative remedies before you can do this.
Yeah, I mean, it was a technical rejection of their lawsuit. It wasn't dismissed on substantive grounds. That he just said you have to go through different processes first before you bring it to me. So they haven't lost.
And in Stockton, California, that police lieutenant who blasted same-sex marriage in the papers using his title and was suspended is back on the job. Some action was taken. But they won't tell us what.
It's a secret punishment.
He referred to our vile and sinful passions and said that the ruling showed that God is giving the nation over to its own destruction. But I haven't noticed the sky falling.
Well, you know, there are floods, there are fires. Who knows whose bad actions caused those?
Yeah.
All right. The Stonewall controversy.
Oh, boy.
So there's this new movie being made called Stonewall that's about the Stonewall Rebellion, being directed by Roland Emmerich, who's an out gay director and who's...
Independence Day. He does all the big blockbusters.
Yep.
He's rich.
What does that have to do with it?
Well, I'm just saying he's got the money to do something like this.
He's a big director. So I think we mentioned this a year or so ago when he started making this, and we were interested in whether a big blockbuster director could make a movie about Stonewall. So he's been working on this, and now there hasn't been much talk about it, but now a trailer has been released from the movie, and people got a look at this trailer, and they lost their minds. And so
well,
we would like...
they objected, let's say that. I want to be careful.
I've been accused of exaggerating. I plead guilty.
There is an outcry.
Yes.
There is quite an outcry.
Well, let's take a look at this trailer, and then we will discuss what the outcry entails.
Our nation was founded on a bedrock principle that we are all created equal.
Seneca Falls, Selma, and Stonewall.
Ordinary people can do extraordinary things.
I already got you all figured out. Grew up in Kansas, and mama pies. Yo, everybody, this is Danny. Danny,
welcome to New York.
And I never should have listened to you.
Don't use your real name. It was run by the mob.
We're an organization that fights for gay rights.
What are you looking at, faggot?
Up against the wall.
This is what we're fighting.
Are you all just standing there?
No way! We have to fight in a peaceful way and resist the radicalism that I see starting to take hold.
I have not seen one dream come true on Christopher Street, baby.
There is no hope. There is no family, Danny.
I like being mad.
These kids have nothing left to lose.
I can't love you.
That's not the way, Danny. It's the only way.
Hey, so we're having a parade to commemorate the fighting. I'm going to call it the Gay Liberation March.
I'm coming.
So, and as you see there, written by John Robin Bates, an out gay playwright, mm-hmm. mostly, who's done a lot of gay themed plays over the years. So, a trans woman, 18 years old, named Pat Cordova Goff, started a boycott petition, and as of the other day, had 22,000 signatures boycotting the movie. But she says she'll call it off if it is what the directors and everybody says it
is. Well, let's talk about what the objections are.
Yes.
The objections are, first of all, that it is a young white gay man at the center of the story.
A boy who was thrown out of his home in the Midwest,
yes.
who comes to New York.
Yes.
And there were street kids, of course, like Tommy Lanigan Schmidt, who we had on this show, who were white and were there and were part of it.
Well, he's a pretty Midwest boy.
Yes. Played by Jeremy Irvine, more about
whom
later.
Who's English.
Yeah, well, wait a minute. A movie in America not populated by English people? Are you kidding?
Well,
I mean, that's all we get these days.
Yes, but you're making a movie about Stonewall. So the objection is that this minimizes the existence and role
yes.
of kids of color, trans people
yes.
who were there, and yeah. and assigns him the role of throwing the first brick and starting the revolution. Now, people object to the fact continually that, you know, one of the title cards there says, "Where Pride Began." But people will point out this was not the only event like this around
yes.
this time.
And of course, as we've discussed since we just went through, you know, the Stonewall commemorations and the fact that it's become a national landmark, the reason it has become so significant is because it did lead to an organized movement after that, whereas these other earlier incidents did not have that kind of follow-through after them, which is why they acquired less significance.
Yes, although you could say there's a sort of larger gestalt of all this.
Yes. Well, Harry Hay, Mattachine
yeah.
early on.
Yes.
Let's go back
But the point
Magnus
is
Hirschfeld in Germany.
The real core of the objection is white gay man non-U.S., I'm going to stick to. We don't know what his sexual orientation in real life is. That doesn't matter so much.
He was the star of The Young Man and War Horse. He was just in a movie we just saw called The Railway which was about where Colin Firth was a prisoner of war.
He played the young Colin Firth.
Right.
The writer, and Jeremy Irvine are all standing up for the movie and saying, wait till you see it. We actually do feature Marsha P. Johnson and Sylvia Rivera, although Sylvia may be a composite character.
Yes.
Give us a chance. We'll see. But I have to say, looking at the trailer, and they say, you know, the movie studio produced the trailer, not the director so much. But it looks pretty homogenized. It's pretty big Hollywood budget. It's not really a gritty, realistic kind of movie.
I love the movie Pride, but remember, we had a big...
It was not a big budget Hollywood movie.
This was not a big budget movie either. It was shot in Canada.
Another issue.
What I'm saying is Roland Emmerich is a very successful director who does have a lot of money, but he couldn't afford to shoot it in New York, he said. Mm-hmm. I mean, he said that. Larry Kramer says, see it first, lay off. And I
do think he hasn't seen it either.
Nobody is. We haven't talked to anybody who's seen the movie yet. So many Hollywood stories are told through the white guy, you know, whether it's about race relations in the South or South Africa, all those things. It's always told through the or these Asian stories that are told from the Western perspective, et cetera. It goes on and on and on and on and on. Now, here's the question. Do you want to draw? Maybe it is a good movie. We don't know. Does that draw people in and get them to go see it? And then they see this diverse group that they say is going to be in this movie or not?
We'll see.
That's what we'll see.
But we just wanted to alert you to the fact that it's coming in September.
I think the end of September.
Yes. September 25th it's supposed to open, and it's controversial. So we'll see what happens when it does open.
Yeah.
All right, back to current real-life stories. A lot of news developments around current transgender people.
Yes. We can start with the good news in California.
Okay.
We have a picture here of Shiloh Quine. The Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation there has settled with this inmate, Shiloh, who is in for life. Shiloh Heavenly Quine, by the way, a trans woman in a men's prison, will now move to a women's facility, and they will provide gender-confirming surgery as it's ordered. Now, it was interesting. There was an earlier case brought by Michelle Norsworthy, who was the first trans inmate who won the right to surgery, but rather than give her the surgery, they granted her parole.
She's out.
So they say, well, that's moot.
And they have agreed to, the California prison system has made a settlement with the Transgender Law Center to now supply appropriate clothes, housing, surgery to transgender inmates on a widespread basis. And this is a big step forward.
Right.
So congratulations on that fight. In Puerto Rico, you talked about the Secretary of Housing coming out. Also, the governor of Puerto Rico mm-hmm. has issued an executive order.
Two executive orders.
Gender identity and expression executive orders that cover hospital care and birth certificate gender change.
Driver's license. Gender change.
You're right. I wrote it down. I was looking at the next story.
That's
sorry.
Right.
It is driver's
and,
license.
And, in 2013, they did add LGBT to the domestic violence laws there. But the LGBT advocates down there say that this is a great step for Puerto Rico.
By the way, a viewer alerted me to a story. I don't know if you've seen this, that Brooklyn Hospital has settled a case with the Federal Office of Civil Rights in reference to appropriate care for transgender patients. Under the rules of the Affordable Care Act, which outlaws sex discrimination, which is interpreted by the federal government in the Affordable Care Act as including gender identity and expression.
I will just say that Kate Barnhart, who is the head of New Alternatives for Homeless LGBT Youth, wrote me an email this week and said, our transgender clients are being treated like crap in hospitals.
Yes.
And I said...
And well, we have laws in this
city.
And
she says, do you want to do a story? Yes, I do want to do a story. We need, but there needs to be complaints that we can cover about these things so that we can get these things adjudicated.
Well, the fact that in New York City, which has had a non-discrimination law for some years now.
Well, transgender rights since 2001 or two, as soon as Bloomberg came in, actually. It's one of the good things that he did.
Almost 15 years,
yeah.
And yet you still have to bring suit against Brooklyn Hospital to get them to treat people correctly.
Well, you can't, and you can't get people to be treated correctly in New Jersey, where Governor Chris Christie, you may know about him, he's running for president, vetoed a bill to let trans people easily change sex markers on their birth certificates. He's concerned about fraud and abuse,
We need more security in this bill. This is the second year in a row he's vetoed this bill.
Well, yes, it's awful.
Yes,
and
it is.
Speaking of awful things, we can get into the two reports of more murders of trans women.
In Detroit, Amber Moore, 20 years old, shot dead.
A student at Wayne State University.
Yes.
The 12th transgender woman. A friend said that she'd been shot two or three times before. But this time, obviously didn't make it.
20.
The murder occurred at 6 Mile and Woodward. No word on a motive. And then in Dallas, Ms. Shade Schuler, 22, a trans woman, was found dead in a field back on July 29th. And see, what's happening with these things is that it took a long time to classify this as a crime against a trans gender person.
Well, her body was badly decomposed because she'd evidently been there for a while. They haven't even determined the cause of death yet, let alone a motive or a perpetrator. But this is now, as you say, 13 documented murders of transgender people, women for the most part, mostly women of color, in 2015, which equals the number in all of 2014. And I continue to believe this is the tip of the iceberg, that we're only hearing about some of these cases. And there is a petition to the White House to ask that they exercise some oversight to make sure these cases are being investigated correctly, that local officials are trained to do the investigations properly, because of course these victims keep getting misgendered in the press and right. by local officials.
But they did make an arrest in Baltimore in the murder of Mia Henderson back on July 16th, who was found in an alley. The suspect, Sean Oliver, 44, there were multiple stabbings, charged with first and second degree murder. So the concern is enforcement and thorough investigations.
Mm-hmm.
Look, folks, we're not saying that there's some guy or person stalking the nation for transgenders, or maybe there is. We'll find out. But that's why you need these investigations. We think it's because people are reporting these things more. There's a transgender advocacy community that makes sure that they're reported right, that kind of thing.
Yes, and because the transgender community is still hugely stigmatized, we assume one of the main drivers of the fact that these murders are occurring. So in dealing with this issue, these may all be individual cases, but they certainly seem to come out of an atmosphere of transphobia.
Hatred, yes.
Yes, and hatred, fear, whatever. And that requires an overall education.
And a lot of these transgender women, especially women of color, living on the edges of society with sex work and
yeah.
with drugs, where there is a lot more violence. And we have to
issues which are being dealt with, by the way, still on I Am Kate, the Caitlyn Jenner series, which I continue to watch. And they are discussing these issues and pointing out to her the different socioeconomic issues.
As opposed to her solution, which is get a job.
Well, she's calmed down from that. Yes, she is taking it to heart. She's listening. She's learning. That's one of the beauties of this whole thing.
I hope that the Democratic convention is vying for her to transition her party.
Well, I suspect that her party, the Republicans, are not vying for her
you
make
never
a
know.
Speech. You never know. Would Trump have her speak? Probably more quickly than some others.
Not the most liberal Democratic mayor, Rahm Emanuel in Chicago, is poised to end the exclusion of gender reassignment services from city health care benefits. It'll now cover all non-union employees, and they have to work it out with their labor partners in the contract process. But it starts for the non-union employees on October 1st.
Can we move to some political news?
Well, there's a couple of more transgender notes.
Okay, go ahead. The
fact that Toys R Us dropping?
I don't know.
Yeah, dropping
all the gender
dropping gender markers on toys. Yeah. They're still going to have it for apparel. And then the University of California.
Why should they have it for apparel?
Okay. We could get into it. I don't want to.
Well, you could have aisles marked dresses
yes.
or pants.
There you are.
You don't have to say girls
yes.
or boys. You
yes.
could just indicate the clothes.
Yes. And they're doing more thorough research at the University of California. Applicants to the system can now choose from 6 gender identities: male, female, trans male, trans female, genderqueer / gender nonconforming, and different. It says it's just being used for demographic purposes. It won't affect your admissions. President of the system, Janet Napolitano, says she wants everyone to feel respected and supported. Well, we'd support you too, Janet, if you would come out.
Thank you, yes. All right, I want to start small and work up to bigger on the political news. In Salt Lake City, they've held a primary, and as somewhat expected, out lesbian Jackie Biskupski has won the mayoral primary. She got 46% of the vote. I think it's a nonpartisan primary with a lot of candidates, because the top two contenders then face off in November, and she will be facing the incumbent mayor, who only got 31% of the vote in November. So she's the one who was endorsed by the Salt Lake paper, and she's doing great.
Salt Lake City generally has much more progressive mayors than New York and Chicago.
Much. So
it is a progressive enclave.
Yes, and one of the plaintiffs in the marriage case in Utah, Derek Kitchen, is in the final race for city council in November in the general election. He got through his primary to that. And a transgender candidate, Sophie Hawes Tingay, made it to the general election for the city council in Midvale, Utah. So congratulations to all of them. And congratulations to my old softball teammate, Paula Foster, out lesbian social worker who's running for the Metro Council in Nashville, Tennessee. She came in second in the primary and has a September 10th runoff. She got 28% of the vote. The winner got 38%. They are running off on September 10th.
In Guam, they passed a marriage equality law there, and they will also they also passed unanimously an employment non-discrimination act that will cover LGBTs and military personnel.
I have to get to my favorite story.
Yes,
Michigan.
I'm leaving it to you since
All
you
right.
love it.
So there are two state representatives in Michigan, Todd Corser and Cindy Gamrat.
Get a picture of them there.
They are charming adulterers, each married to someone else and having an affair with each other.
Well, not just that, but even though their districts are 100 miles apart, let's share our staff. There was one of your clues.
So they're having this covert affair. And by
not
the way,
so everybody knows
they're
about
very
it.
Family values
oh.
types. They're Republicans, and they're anti-gay,
well,
and they're...
And they're having a traditional affair.
Yes, a traditional man-woman affair. But they were afraid of what people would think if they found out. So Todd started a rumor.
Well, first he asked a staffer to start the rumor for him.
You tell.
Well, that part. I mean, he asks the staffer to send an email saying that he, Todd himself, is into drugs and gay sex. Now, why is he doing this? To deflect from the fact that it's going to come out that he's having the affair with Cindy.
Yeah.
But
and make the affair with Cindy seem Like, no big deal.
But he says, hey, I'm being blackmailed because of the affair with Cindy, and I needed to do this to deflect the blackmailer. Oh, my God. So
why is it always our fault?
They're Tea Partiers. They're praying for them, but they've also asked them to resign, and he won't.
No.
Wait a minute. He apologized. He apologized to God. He does not know how he can get past the guilt and shame that he feels now. Well, God will help.
Why do they feel guilt and shame after they're caught and not while they're doing it?
Yeah.
What
man,
a story.
Man, oh, man. And you how about having a little compassion?
I want to see the movie on this.
You would think it would give them a little insight into having compassion for others who they've been stigmatizing all their lives.
No.
But
they are oblivious. They
it
are
doesn't.
Absolutely oblivious. All right. So in Houston, where the human rights,
Equal Rights Ordinance.
Thank you.
It's called Houston Equal
yes.
Rights Ordinance.
It was passed by the city council. The right wing tried to call for a referendum on it to get it repealed. They gathered enough signatures, but then the signatures were disqualified. But then the court said, well, you can't, it's too late. You already said there were enough signatures, even if they're all fraudulent.
Right. That's what happened.
So you have to either repeal it or hold a public referendum on it. So the city council has now reaffirmed its support for HERO.
By a 12-5 vote.
And scheduled a public vote on it in November.
And I need you to concentrate on this. A yes vote is for repeal. So if you want to get rid of the ordinance, you have to vote yes on it.
But if you want to support the referendum.
You need to vote no.
I don't like that.
Well,
I think that's
our
very
side did
risky.
This.
I think it's very risky.
This is with a lesbian mayor in East Parker, yeah. Out lesbian.
Usually the thinking is that you set it up so that a no vote, because you think the voters are going to vote no to human rights, so you set it up so that a no vote will actually keep the ordinance.
But a no vote?
Really risky.
A no vote would keep the ordinance.
Yes, and I'm saying I think that's a risky strategy.
Okay.
And to have our people going out and saying, vote no, I think is a kind of negative campaign. Good news from the Republican National Committee summer meeting, which rejected the anti-gay resolutions proposed by a right-wing Michigan politician. So we got through that. But then the debates.
Well, yeah, sure. Let's talk about the debates.
Okay. So it was pretty entertaining.
The questions were. Woo!
Yes, I agree with the majority who think that the Fox questioners did a pretty good job. Now, there are a lot of questions they could have asked that they didn't, but they only had 2 hours in Ted candidates.
And there's no follow-up. I mean, I guess we should talk about the LGBT issues that were addressed in the thing. Huckabee was the one asked about transgender soldiers, and he said, oh, that's a social experiment, and the military is for killing and breaking things.
Yeah, love
that. You make a great president.
Yeah. Santorum.
I don't think anybody in the military is going to vote for you.
Santorum is still comparing the Supreme Court marriage decision to Dred Scott, which reinforced segregation, and says that no, it is not a done deal and should be reversed by a constitutional amendment or a new Supreme Court or something.
Bobby Jindal, in the Tier 2 debate, was asked about a same-sex marriage, and he was took it as an opportunity to talk about religious freedom, and he will do an executive order as president. And by the way, on religious freedom, by the way, they all basically all said, the first thing I'm going to do is rescind every executive order Barack Obama ever signed. I mean, it's like carnage.
It's so anti-intellectual. It is so stupid. It's so, an attempt to appeal on some visceral level to some hatred of Obama. It bears no relation to reality.
They are willing to take you to war in Iran to show how anti-Obama they are.
Rand Paul wants religious freedom, and he specifically singled out the lesbian mayor of Houston, Anise Parker, for going after those sermons that that wanted repeal of the Equal Rights Ordinance.
Like he cares.
Oh, really?
And then, you know, a lot of people have been giving credit to Governor Kasich of Ohio, who was asked about same-sex marriage directly. So he starts out by saying, "Well, I'm a traditional guy. Marriage between
well,
a man,
the question
a man
was,
and a woman.
How do you explain your opposition to same-sex marriage to your daughter if she turns out to be a lesbian?
I would love her. I would love her," he said. And by the way, I went to a gay friend's wedding. And then people in this Fox News audience start applauding. Of course, they're his buddies in Ohio.
Well, 4 years ago, they were booing the gay soldier, or maybe 8 years ago.
Yeah. Well, he's at about 2% of the polls, although he's up now to 12% in New Hampshire.
I thought he acquitted himself as an adult human being as opposed to the rest of them.
Yes, an adult human being who is still opposed to our rights.
Exactly. He's, you know, still very right-wing.
They want to soften it as human beings and say, well, as a person, I accept you, but I don't think you should have civil rights. So the hell with you.
Jimmy LaSalvia, the former head of GoProud, the most conservative, I guess, gay Republican organization, said that Fox orchestrated that question to Kasich because they're trying to elect a Republican, and they think the way to do it is to pick out a softer, more moderate-sounding Republican.
Well, my God, when you ask them about abortion and Planned Parenthood, defund Planned Parenthood entirely. By the way, Planned Parenthood just got a $992 million donation from Mark Zuckerberg. They only get $500 million from all government sources combined. So that's a major offset if they lose their...
It was so depressing to watch those candidates brag about who had defunded Planned Parenthood faster or earlier.
Planned Parenthood used to be a mainstream Republican cause.
Absolutely.
Republican cause.
Absolutely.
Because they were for... family planning, yep.
And women's health.
Yes.
Speaking of which, Donald Trump.
Well, we've missed the elephant in the room. Look, you've all heard this and heard his answers to his whole, whether he's a misogynist or not. I mean, certainly given the way he's treated
some... You know, I thought the whole thing about the Rosie O'Donnell thing, people were jumping on him for that, and I thought, these people don't know that he was in a feud with her for years. They think he just plucked her name out of the air.
Yes, he was asked by Megyn Kelly, is that
yes.
her name? You've called women fat slobs and pigs, and he says, that's just Rosie O'Donnell. But the whole thing was kind of vile, and he's kind of vile on those things.
Horrible.
But
then he's right about how vile the other politicians are.
Right. And he never apologizes for anything.
No, but he, and when you call him a whiner, he says, yes, I'm a whiner. I'm proud to be a whiner. That's how I win. And I will negotiate the return of America to greatness.
But the problem with all the focus on that question with Trump was that it took away from the anti-woman stuff on the agenda of every person on that platform.
Well, I was happy to see that Hillary Clinton pointed that out and said, clearly his statements are horrible, but so are all the anti-woman statements of all the other candidates. And all this, I like the debate, I like the sharp questioning, I didn't like the lack of follow-up, I didn't like the fact that there were a lot of questions missing about policy, but...
I think we need a group called Women's Lives Matter to disrupt Republican rallies.
Well, whatever.
All right.
I'm happy to have the Black Lives Matter people continue.
Absolutely. And by the way, following up on another crime story in New York City, we told you about the West Point graduates who married each other and fought back against a gay bashing in Soho.
They're on the left there.
Daniel and Larry Lennox Choate. Well, they arrested the guy on the right. His name is Thomas Klobaugh, 57, of Corona, Queens. Assault as a hate crime is the charge.
And in Kentucky, a high school senior out gay basketball player, Dalton Maldonado, came out this spring, was harassed by opponents on the high school basketball court. A starting player for the Betsy Lane High School in Kentucky was left out of the yearbook team picture No explanation from the school administration, refusal to talk about it, and he's devastated.
Well, you want to hear a more devastating story? It comes out of Indiana, out of Fort Wayne. A seven-year-old who he responded to a classmate's question on why he didn't go to church, and he told her, "Well, it's because I don't believe in God." And the teacher heard about this, put him in 3 days of isolation. No one's allowed to talk to him. The ACLU is suing. The kid came home crying every day. Now, the school found out about this, the larger administration, and the sanctions have been lifted. But the kid says the classmates now all hate him, and the ACLU wants more of a remedy. You know, they keep talking about religious freedom, but when you try to express yourself on religious things, they want to isolate you.
Yeah, where is the Alliance Defending Freedom on this case?
Yes.
All right, international news?
Yes, please.
Well, I think Australia is really the headline.
Yes.
There will be a same-sex marriage bill introduced in the parliament, and the attempt was to make it bipartisan. But the Prime Minister of Australia, as we've told you many times, Tony Abbott, is the head of the Liberal Party, which is a conservative party in Australia.
And he rules over a conservative coalition. He has even farther right partners in the coalition.
The National Party.
Yes.
So his party, the Liberals, were going to have a private meeting to discuss what they were going to do about the marriage bill, whether there would be a free vote on it, people could vote their conscience, or whether they had to be disciplined to a party line. He opposes same-sex marriage. So he brings the National Party members into this meeting without anyone else's agreement to this. And they scuttle the idea of a free vote.
Well, the vote of the coalition was 66 to 33 against
a
same-sex marriage, against bringing it up. And this means as long as they're in power, they're not going to bring it up. Now, how do you get a referendum on this is the only way to get around this. But the thing is, our side says we will take a referendum, but the government should vote for a referendum and put it on the ballot when you're all up for re-election.
Yes. And the bill, I think, is still going to be introduced, and the LGBT activists in Australia are still urging people to cross party lines and vote for it. But the government is now saying, if you do that, we are destroying your party hierarchy. We're taking you off the front bench and putting you in the back bench.
And if
you
you're
will
on the back
bench,
and if you're on the back bench, you're not going to. They can't. Apparently, they can even expel you from the party if they want. I don't know if they would go that far, but certainly, if you're a backbencher and you ever aspire to being part of the government and running something, you're not going to vote for it either.
The run-up to this has been television ads, pro and con, and the capital of Australia's Canberra. And when legislators arrived recently for the legislative session, they were greeted by rainbow lights at Canberra Airport because it's owned by people who are pro-gay. And they also have this slogan, this pro-marriage equality slogan on display, "We can do this."
Now, Rodney Croom, who's head of Australian marriage equality, says the coalition knows that it doesn't have the votes to stop it on the floor if it doesn't use this discipline stuff.
Hundreds of corporations have come out in favor of marriage equality. There have been big demos for and against.
Well,
but they're really throwing a monkey wrench.
I mean,
in this.
You know, Tony Abbott started out as a candidate for the Catholic priesthood. I mean, 19 countries now have marriage equality. They're going to have a big rally in Melbourne on August 15th about this. But the right wing is in gear about it as well.
All right. Well, meanwhile, in Poland, the Senate there has passed the Gender Accordance Act, which allows people to change their gender if they are a citizen, unmarried, and have two doctor's notes and a psychologist present in court.
And a sexologist. And if you've got kids, you've got to have a pediatric psychologist there to certify that this is all okay. Mm. But it's still considered a step forward. because it used to be a much more confusing legal process.
They've had very right-wing leadership for years.
In Malaysia, Secretary Kerry met with the Prime Minister there, Najib Razak, and he raised the issue of the sodomy conviction of former Deputy Prime Minister Anwar Ibrahim, who is in prison, and also raised the issue of whether this guy is in prison is getting the needed medical attention. Malaysia, of course, is poised to join the TPP with us.
In Mexico, the Supreme Court has struck down the ban on same-sex couples adopting in one district of the country. This is separate from any of the marriage rulings they're doing, but that's a big step forward.
They had a nice pride celebration in Iceland in Reykjavik. They painted the street rainbow. The mayor helped with the paint job, and a lot of kids just thought this was just so much fun, and they joined in. Look, it's quite a job there.
Hand-painted.
The street.
Yeah. And they're going to leave it like that for a while.
I can't even get my apartment painted.
Yes, you can. You just haven't done anything to make it happen. Jamaica, we told you about a week of pride in Kingston. Well, then they had a pride in Montego Bay.
Oh, they're going to. Montego Bay is on October 25th.
You're right.
But they did the one in Kingston.
Yes.
And there's a picture of Ellen Page and Karen Lloyd, who was a local activist there, who were there for this. You know, the way they have to do this is they have to do like flash mobs.
Yes.
And if you want to be part of the Montego, if you want to be part of Montego Bay Pride, for instance, go to Facebook. You got to get information about it. Mm-hmm. They've got to make sure that you're okay, and then they're going to tell you about it and how to do it, because they have to do things somewhat sub rosa, lest they meet opposition.
And Ellen Page is producing and starring in the movie Freeheld about Freehold, New Jersey Sergeant Laurel Hester that's coming out in October. If we have time, we'll show you the trailer for that.
We will. The Pope says those who are divorced and remarried are not all excommunicated, and the church doors should be wide open to them. But then the official Vatican spokespersons speak out and they say, well, they're still barred from the sacraments and nothing has changed. You know, Francis is coming to New York and Philadelphia in September. These family issues are going to be debated in the Vatican in October.
And
a debate in the Catholic Church. It's not a fair fight.
Well, it's they've been gathering information for a couple of years and everyone is on there. Toes waiting to hear what's
and then there
happen.
Was pride in Uganda in Entebbe. We have a picture of that. There were 300 who marched there despite threats, and the U.S. State Department attended
Embassy.
A cocktail party on August the 5th to kick things off.
That's a good thing.
Yes, it is.
And in Hanoi, Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg was on a visit there on a State Department speaker's travel thing. And she stayed with the U.S. ambassador, who is the out gay man, and his husband and their child.
The most famous gay couple in Vietnam.
And so it was suggested to this couple that they renew their vows and have Ruth perform the ceremony.
The paint isn't even dry on the Obergefell decision, and she's out there doing that.
More weddings.
And let me tell you.
In Hanoi, for the out gay U.S. ambassador with Vietnamese LGBT activists in attendance. They did it so that they could be an example for Vietnam about how this could happen.
Hey, good news from Nigeria, where 130 million girls later, female genital mutilation has been banned.
In Winnipeg, Canada, there is a controversy because the Bethlehem Aboriginal Fellowship requires church service attendants to use its food bank and
yes.
requires volunteers who are serving the food to sign a form, quote, respecting the relationship of only a man and woman in marriage. Now, of course, this food bank is somewhat financed by the government, so
yes.
this is...
Well, I mean, you know, we told you about how the Diocese of Bismarck in this country, you know, opted out of the Boy Scouts. The bishop there said, we cannot permit our Catholic institutions to accept and participate directly or indirectly in any organization which has policies and methods which contradict the authoritative moral teachings of the Catholic Church. Wow! That's a mouthful there, Bishop, and you better think about some of the people you associate, or maybe where you go out to eat.
Well, you have said
for years. Or insurance companies that you use, or whatever.
We have discussed for years on this show the idea that it is good for the Catholic Church to stand up for its values,
yes,
because then it reveals itself to people, and people can make their choices.
I hope you're getting the message.
Want to be associated with that.
By the way, in
South Africa?
Yeah, Mr. Gay World 2010, Charles Vandenberg, a South African human rights activist, has died, sadly, of lymphatic cancer at the age of 33. He was traveling all over the world spreading the, you know, good cheer and human rights. And then in Nepal, they're now issuing its third gender passports, which has a category for other, if you don't want to identify as M or F. And Australia and New Zealand use this third category of X.
Okay. AIDS news.
Yeah.
What you got?
Well, in Brisbane, Australia, Philip Johnson, 48, began a consensual sexual encounter in June with another man, but it crossed over the line into rape. So we don't have the name of the rape victim, of course. After the attack, Jason stole the victim's bag, phone, and sunglasses, and so he's arrested, and now he is seeking clemency because this rape survivor is HIV positive.
Clemency?
Wow. Causing him distress, and the judge said, irrelevant, and sentenced him.
Well, get over yourself.
He's only being sentenced to 2.5 years. And then
for rape?
There's a research story in Israel, if you'd like to hear about it.
Well, try me.
Well, they found similarities between HIV and leukemia. This is about dealing with the latent particles of HIV that can't be treated by the antiretrovirals,
yes,
which lets them then infect new cells.
Sure.
So they're working on activating the silenced virus and activating then antiviral suppression to destroy the virus entirely.
They've been trying that for years.
Well, it's a new study.
Well, I hope they do well at it. We're going to discuss that and some other issues next week on this show. We're going to devote the show to a discussion with long-term survivors of HIV and AIDS. We have assembled an all-star panel, and we're going to hear about their lives and about some of the issues currently around HIV and AIDS, and it should be a fascinating hour.
We're going to have Sean Stroob, who is the founder of POS Magazine and runs the HIV Criminalization Project, our friend Mark Milano from ACT UP, Reginald Brown from Vocal, who is a housing activist,
and Sean McKenna, who's just revived the buddy groups at GMHC.
So it's going to be a very interesting discussion.
Yeah.
We're going to do that for the whole hour next week.
Highly, if any news breaks out,
we will certainly let you know.
Throw that in. Entertainment news. I have some non-LGBT entertainment news just because I saw a movie that I so highly recommend. It's absolutely devastating, and that is the Amy Winehouse documentary, Amy. It does so much to you. First of all, you're reminded of what an incredible talent she was. Her voice just goes right through you from head to toe, and what a huge loss her short life is. And they have the most amazing collection of footage from when she was about 12, and her with her girlfriends and her and just being an innocent little girl trying to have the singing career. Her father was a mess and messed her up, and of course her boyfriend, husband Blake, who really led her into drug addiction. It just broke my heart about 10 times through the course of the movie, and it is so powerful and so real and so devastating. So it's some of it is hard to watch because it is so sad, but it's just a hugely powerful movie, and I don't see many of those these days. So Amy is a movie I think you would all... I won't say enjoy.
Where's it playing?
It's playing at a couple of theaters here, and I'm sure it's playing periodically around the country. But Amy, look for Amy.
I will. for fans of HBO's Looking, they are looking to get the movie out in the spring, the two-hour movie, to sum up things. It's shooting this fall, though Jonathan Groff is on Broadway in Hamilton as George III. We're seeing him. Maybe he's leaving it to do that. So we'll see.
I'm sure they'll work around his schedule to do that. I also saw the Brian Wilson movie, Love and Mercy, Brian Wilson of the Beach Boys. That's not quite as devastating as Amy, but it's, you know, it's moving and weird. And he's played at two different ages by John Cusack and Paul Dano.
Yeah.
And I would have liked more Beach Boys music in it, but there's one particular sequence where he's creating one particular song that's just fascinating. It's wonderful to watch him in the studio putting together all the little details. And horrible to see the psychiatrist played by Paul Giamatti, who really ruled his life for a long time. And
he makes a good bad guy, Paul Giamatti.
Yes, and Elizabeth Banks plays the woman who sort of rescues him from him. So Love and Mercy, if that's playing near you, it's worth seeing.
Good.
And at the Film Forum currently, How to Smell a Rose, A Visit with Ricky Leacock in Normandy is a documentary about the famous documentary filmmaker. And are you looking at me because you think we should run the Freeheld
trailer? If you'd
trailer?
Like to. Okay. We don't have to.
Well, let's...
Freeheld is the movie about Lieutenant
Laurel Hester.
I don't
think we have time for the
whole thing. We'll go out with that. This stars Julianne Moore and Ellen Page and Michael Shannon.
And opens
and
in October. Carell,
as our friend Steve Goldstein.
Yeah. Go ahead. Run that and run the credits over.
Thanks. If you can.
Yeah. Hey, can I have your number?
Hello?
It's Stacy from Volleyball.
Listen, I can't talk right now.
Hey, go right ahead.
Just your run-of-the-mill double homicide investigation.
Shut up. Can I call you later?
You got a date?
Yeah, I do. If you could have anything, what would it be? What's your dream?
A house, a dog, a woman I love, loves me.
Me too.
Give me a second here. This domestic partnership thing is new.
Kind of like the idea of you as a kept woman.
What's the matter?
I don't know. I think you pulled a muscle.
Well, you get it checked out?
Yeah. My name is Detective Laurel Hester. I've worked for the Ocean County Police Department for 23 years. Recently, I was diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer. When my heterosexual colleagues die, their pensions go to their spouses. But because my partner is a woman, I don't get to do that. In my career, I've never asked for special treatment. I'm only asking for equality.
We anguish over this situation, but we have to deny your request.
This is an outrageous miscarriage of justice. Their next meeting, we show up with 100 protesters.
Radicals and strangers from New York aren't going to convince these guys.
I am not a radical. I am a middle-class Jewish homosexual from New Jersey. How about you, sweetheart?
I'm a straight, white, ex-Protestant, atheist cop. You okay with that, sweetheart?
I am. That is very hot.
I'm worried about Stacy. She's had so much to deal with. You know, she's so young.
I love you.
It's not fair.
No, it isn't.
I know you feel like crying. I want to tell you about our house. Just really like to hold on to it.
Remember how much we love each other.
If they say yes, then my tax dollars go to her girlfriend.
Yeah, the same way your wife gets your pension if you die.
Yeah, but she's my wife.
Hell, if you and I got married tomorrow, I'd be entitled to your benefits.
Is that a proposal?
Oh, my God.
We are sticking to a losing position because of some personal beliefs.
It's an opportunity to change the world.